Today, Ismael Medina is going to present about optimal transport. So he's working with Professor Bernhard Schmitzer from Göttingen University. They are part of the optimal transport group, of course. I knew Ismael from my master's degree at the Technical University Munich. He's a mathematician. We did some courses in optimal transport, and then he continued his master's thesis in optimal transport, and now his PhD project in optimal transport. And he's going to talk a little bit about the theory, about some applications, and about his specific project on domain decomposition for efficiently computing the optimal transport problem. And well, I think I will give the word to Ismael. He will tell you more details.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here and to talk about this topic. Wait a second, I didn't hide my self view and I'm very self-conscious. So okay, now it's much better. So I will structure this into, let's see. Yeah, exactly. I will structure this into three parts. I will first introduce optimal transport, which is a way of measuring distances in between probability measures, and to give a way of transforming one measure into another, in kind of the optimal way in some sense. Then the next part will be about the applications of this optimal transport. It has a very large number of applications in the natural sciences, in computer science, in mathematics itself, though we won't dwell a lot on that. And then finally, we will talk, when we are convinced that this thing is useful, about the numerics of optimal transport. How do we solve it? And in particular about my work in domain decomposition. That is a way of solving very big optimal transport problems in a distributed way. So yeah, without further introduction, let's show the problem. So I have to do this smaller. Let's see, okay, like this. So we're interested in finding a distance between probability measures that in some way captures the underlying distance of the metric space where that probability measure is embedded. So there are already some distances in the probability measure space, for example, the total variation distance. Maybe you are familiar with this, but in case not, it's okay. And now my pen stopped working. That's not nice. Let's see if restarting it works. So this total variation distance essentially measures the point-wise discrepancy. Now it works. This is quite bad because I put a lot of so I based my talk a lot on making drawings on top of this. But let's see. Now it seems to work. Okay, so this total variation distance measures like the point-wise discrepancy between two probability measures. For example, if we have one here and another here, mu and nu, total variation distance between these two measures would be you subtract them and integrate the absolute value and take 1/2. So for this case would be just 1 because the you get the whole integral. So yeah, exactly. You are seeing here that we are taking differences between the two measures. And then this doesn't lend itself to the distance of the metric space here, the real line is not, plays no role in this. So we could have here another probability measure, nu prime, and still the distance between mu and nu prime would be the same in this total variation sense. So we don't want that. We want something that where the distance plays a role, and in particular that for example, if we have two deltas, for example, where an x and another at y, then this distance that we are looking for gives us exactly the distance between the two points. Because this will give us a distance that has much more geometric meaning and that allows us to interpolate and to do more things. So with that in mind, let's formulate the original formulation of the OT problem, which was in the 1700, in the 1800. And the original formulation was the following. Monge was interested on engineering problems, and he had this idea of, okay, so if we have a pile of sand that has a certain shape, and we have another hole or we want to transport it to another pile of sand with another different shape, what would be the optimal way to move it using the least cost in the process? So here it's important that we empty completely the first pile of sand, and then we fill completely the hole, or that we fill completely the new shape of the pile of sand. So for the cost of moving one column of mass to another position, he was interested mostly on the Euclidean distance between these two positions. And well, so this was the original formulation of the problem. We want to minimize the cost of sending each position to each new position that is encoded by this map T. We have to weight each of these costs with the mass that we are sending, so with the column of mass that lives at the original X. And we have to ensure that we empty completely the original pile of sand and we fill the new hole. So this is given by this condition, that means that T is a measure preserving map. So I transform the measure mu to give the measure mu. And as you see here, this problem is very nonlinear, because this cost could be in principle anything, any reasonable thing. And then if you introduce a function here, it's highly nonlinear. And also the constraint is highly nonlinear, because this condition of being measure preserving, even if this mu and nu were differentiable, had differentiable densities, and T was a differentiable function, this could be translated into a condition on the Jacobian on T, so that this change of variables gives gives a measure preserving map. And this condition is a PDE that is also highly nonlinear. So we certainly need something better or easier to treat this problem. And this idea was hanging for some centuries, until in the 50s, I think, or in the 40s, Kantorowicz came with a relaxed version of this OT problem. And in its relaxed version, we will show it first in the discrete setting, because it's easier to understand, I think. So we have a measure that is supported on some points, X, and has some masses on each point, mu I, and the same in Y, on some points, YJ, and masses, nu J. And we have a cost matrix that is basically each entry is the cost of sending each point xi to yj. And we want to minimize the total cost of a transport plan, it's called this pi. And this transport plan, all the rows must add up to mu I. So when we sum up j, we get each entry of the original measure. And each column must add up to mu j. So that is the way of encoding this transport into a matrix. This ensures that we send all the mass to original, all the source mass to all the target. And here we have some examples. For example, if we are sending just 3 points to 3 points, then this is basically an assignment problem. Maybe you have heard of this. And then if these are number like 1, 2, 3, and this 1, 2, 3, then the transport matrix would be something diagonal. But this problem is actually nicer than the previous one, because it allows us to split mass, something that we couldn't do with the original formulation. In this case, for example, we could send 1 point to two locations. So the first point, the first mass sends one unit of mass to the first location and one unit of mass to the second location, and then the third point gets the second point gets mapped to the third location. So in that sense, it's nicer than the Munch problem. It's a relaxation. It has the Munch problem as a subset of its, and it's also has a nicer structure because it's linear. So here the objective function is linear on pi. It's just a linear product, and then the constraints are also linear. The rows and the columns adapt to mu and nu. So this turns out to be the right formulation that we need to develop the rest of the theory. And I will just give here so the continuous version, that is when we have arbitrary probability measures, mu and nu, we have a cost. And then what we have to minimize is the total cost with respect to some transport plan, which now is a probability measure. It's a coupling between mu and nu. That means that has mu as first marginal and nu as second marginal. And yeah, we have to minimize over all the couplings, all the feasible couplings, to get the best transport cost. And just so that mathematicians are assured, this problem has minimizers under very mild conditions on the cost. So for example, for bounded from below cost, this has automatically, so a bounded lower semi-continuous cost, this has minimizers. And a second thing is that these minimizers are generally very sparse. So if you have a cost function that is of the form h of x minus y with h some strictly convex function, so for example x minus y to the squared or something like this, then there's a theorem that we won't get into detail now, but so that you know, that says that the OT plan, the optimal plan, lives on the graph of a map. So it has this kind of structure. I mean, there's a lot more structure, but we won't get into those details. And yeah, exactly. So in particular, in these cases, when we have strictly convex costs, we obtain minimizers for the Munch problem that we saw at the beginning. We have actually some transport map that says this. All this column of mass has to be moved to this position or something like that. But then we are usually concerned actually with discrete problems because we want to solve it in our computers, at least from when we are talking about applications. So in the discrete setting, we are also, so we get also a lot of sparsity. We cannot say anymore that the support of the optimal plan lives on the graph of a map, but usually the support of these problems with strictly convex costs is also very, very sparse. And this gives us a bit of hope that we can design efficient solvers to solve this problem, even though we are looking for something that lives on the product space. So it lives on the product of X times Y. Yeah, exactly. So now that we know a bit about what the optimal transport problem is, it's time to define the distance that we were looking for at the beginning. And this distance can be defined under very, very mild assumptions on the space. So I'm saying here bounded because it's easier to discuss about it, but it doesn't even need to be bounded if you have other assumptions. Then for any mu and nu probability measures on this metric space, then you can define a distance, the Wasserstein P distance, in the following way. You find the optimal solution to the optimal transport problem. So here for the cost, that is the distance to the P, to the Pth power. And then you take this score and raise it to the 1/P. So this is very similar, of course, to LP distances, but here you have to solve a minimization problem. And it turns out that this thing defines a distance on the space of probability measures supported on X. I think this is kind of intuitive. So if you have here a probability measure, and then you have here another probability measure, and you have a map that shows you how to turn one into each other in an optimal way, then it seems that, I don't know, of course, you have to go over the details of the proof, but this roughly gives you the distance between these two probability measures. And in fact, if one probability measure is that it's a displacement of the other, we are in an Euclidean space, and the second probability measure is mu times, I'm not writing this properly. So this would be, mu of x would be like something like mu of x plus a or minus a here. So what I mean is that you have one probability measure with one shape, and then you have the displacement here with the same shape. Then the distance between these two probability measures is precisely this vector that gets you from one to the other, or the module of this vector. So that's, I think, a very nice property. This is exactly what we were looking for at the beginning, something that for deltas that are in x and y gives us the distance between x and y. Another nice property of this Bassestein distance is that it metrizes weak star convergence. So weak star convergence means the following: if mu n converges, probability measure converges weak star to mu, it means that for any phi continuous function on this space, then the integral converges. And this is probably most of you knew about this, but this is the convergence that we are interested with mostly when we are talking about measures, because it's the one that allows us precisely to do this kind of arguments with continuous function. And yeah, exactly. So the WP distance metrizes this weak convergence, which means that this weak convergence is the same as saying that the Bassestein distance between mu n and mu goes to zero as n goes to infinity. So that's also, I think, a very nice property. And yes, the last property that I want to show is that if your space where your measures are supported is convex, it's a part of RD and it's convex, then this space of probability measures plus the Bassestein distance is a geodesic space. So we have a geodesics with respect to the Bassestein distance between any two of these measures. And the interpolation, so this geodesic between measures, is basically given by this fact that we have this transport map T. And so moving along this map, so for example, for if this is a T equals zero and this is a T equals one, if we move along this map, so this would be for T equals 0.5, for example, then we interpolate between one probability measure and the other probability measure at constant speed. So yeah, exactly. That's something that gets used a lot in the applications as well. So yeah, I think that this is everything I wanted to tell about optimal transport. I know that it was a bit a rushed introduction to the topic, but if you have any question, we can, if something was not clear. Okay, so now that we know a bit what optimal transport is about, we will talk a bit about the applications, and I've selected some of them. For example, there's this application to machine learning in which you use the Bassestein laws in a classification task. So in the classification task, I think that the softmax laws is usually used, but this penalizes a lot maybe classes that are not so different. For example, in this example, we have two dogs that are very, very different between them, and it seems that wrong to just penalize them a misclassification in the same way. So by setting a distance between these classes, so between these levels, very small, and maybe a distance between a husky and a car much bigger, You can train the model to have a classification that doesn't penalize so much these small misclassifications between these two. And it turns out that the Bassestein distance is I think it's not differentiable, but it has a subdifferential. if you compute it the right way, or if you compute an approximation to it, you can also have make it differentiable. So this fits very well into all the machine learning workflows. Another application of this Wasserstein distance to neural networks is the so-called Wasserstein GAN, in which, okay, so in generative adversarial neural networks, as far as I know, I'm not an expert in the topic, but you want to train your generator to generate samples from a probability distribution, and you have some samples of this probability distribution already in your data set. And so something that you can do is to try to find the probability, the parameterized probability distribution that is closest to this probability distribution of your data set, minimizing the KL divergence. But the KL divergence can explode quite easily. For example, the set where the data set lives has very, very small dimension. Maybe you don't have a density with respect to that data set, and then you explode. And that's a problem that Wasserstein distance is completely unaffected by. So it doesn't care about the dimension of the embedded data set. It will just show you the thing that is closer to your other probability measure in the weak star sense. So with respect to the weak star convergence. So that's also a very nice application of the Wasserstein distance of optimal transport. And in particular, in the paper, they also claim that it gives very, very clean gradients. So in comparison with the gradients that you would get when you use the KL. So that's another point in its favor, I think. Another thing that you can do is to use it to analyze biological data, for example. So for example, here we have a couple of images of a couple of frames of a video of two cells interacting. And what we see is fluorescent molecules, so concentration of fluorescent molecules. So if we get the transport map between these two images, we are seeing where these molecules are going to from one picture to the other. Maybe it's not the true path, but it's the most likely path according to the cost that we have placed on this problem. And so, exactly, it can be used to analyze this kind of interactions. I think that's also a very nice application. There are some variations of this, maybe allowing a bit of mass creation and distraction, but we will not get into this now. And another thing that maybe you are also interested in is that some evolution equations can be seen as gradient flows on Wasserstein space. So with respect to the Wasserstein distance. So in these cases, of course, we are talking about weak solutions, and so our variable is our rho, that's a probability density, again, or a probability measure. And from the modeling point of view, at least, this would make total sense, because all these conservation equations, of course, preserve the mass. So in principle, it could make sense to model them as probability measures. Of course, it has some cost in terms of the computation of it, because computing Wasserstein distance is not easy. You have to define to solve a minimization problem. That's for sure. But it also brings some good things. For example, it makes you be able to deal with non-differentiable energy functions. For example, in crowd motion models, you sometimes have some hard limit on the conjunction. So a lot of pedestrians cannot be in the same place, that's for sure. So that's modeled by in some models by a discontinuous cut. And then you cannot compute derivatives there, but you can do if you consider this as something that a probability measure is trying to minimize. And on the other hand, you can handle very degenerate geometries. For example, if you have maybe some square with some density, and then you have a segment, and then you have another square, so here maybe homogeneous density in the square, and here homogeneous density on the line, all with the same mass, you can handle this very easily with probability measures, because there's no problem gluing this. But maybe if you try to handle this with functions, then you should make here the channel have non-zero width. Yeah, this is not exactly my topic, but I know that there's a lot of people using these gradient flows in Wasserstein space, and I think that there are some applications to it. So yeah, exactly. Now, I think I have a last slide about this is a simulation of the porous medium equation by my supervisor, Bernhard Schmitzer, and how he does it with these OT solvers. It preserves the compact domain of the porous medium solution. So, but now, okay, we know that there's applications for OT, but what about the numerics? How do we compute the OT solutions? And the first thing, okay, so just, yeah, exactly. So let's just consider the discrete version of the problem, because otherwise it gets much more difficult. We are just trying to minimize this total cost of the transport plan subject to the right marginals. And then the first thing that we could do with OT is to notice that it's a linear problem. So as you saw here, it's just a linear problem. In the constraints, we can use, for example, the simplex algorithm. But actually, it works. It has a bad running time. So even if you try to keep the support of the transport plan sparse, you run into trouble. And in fact, it's so state of the art thing is running in quadratic time. So this might not be enough for what we want to do. Another possibilities are solving the Mohn-Schumper equation, that is this condition on the Jacobian that I was talking about at the beginning. So trying to find a measure preserving map, and by imposing those partial differential equations and solving it. But this is again difficult. Other is considering semi-discrete transport, where you just discretize only one of the measures that you want to, one of the two marginals, and then the other you consider it's a homogeneous or sorry a density in the domain. And then the optimal transport is an assignment of regions to a point, so it could look like a Voronoi map more or less, so with different sizes. But this again only works well for certain costs, for example, for the square cost, and that's mostly it. So we'd want something more flexible. And in the last years, entropy regularized OT that I will explain now has become very widespread. And the idea behind this entropy regularization is to minimize not just the transport cost, but add a bit of entropy. So this term here, adds a bit of blur to the transport plan, so it makes it so it penalizes a lot not being homogeneous, and so as you increase the epsilon, you get increasingly homogeneous transport plans. For a small epsilon, though, the transport part plays a bigger role. And then you get something that is just a bit blurred and around the support of the original transport plan. And so if you choose this regularization is small enough, it well may be good enough for your purposes. And beside of that, this regularization makes the problem strictly convex, so it has a unique minimizer regardless of the cost. And it also makes it differentiable. So you can introduce this into your machine learning workflows and get some smooth gradients, some nice gradients. So this is optimal, entropic regularization. And I will just write a bit because I think it's out of fun how does this work, how we can get an algorithm to compute this entropy regularized optimal transport. And it all hinges on this theorem that for every epsilon bigger than zero, if you compute this k, this matrix k, that is the exponential of minus the cost over epsilon. So this is element-wise exponential, okay? Then your optimal coupling is given by just a scaling of the rows and of the columns of k. So we scale each row of k by one value and each column of k by another value that we take into two vectors. And yeah, so if we just find these two vectors u and v that scale k to yeah, sorry. We just have to find this u and v that are the optimals and that is scale k to be the optimal transport plan. And how to find them? Well, this pi has still to have the correct marginals. So we have that pi I must be equal to the sum of pi ij over j. So in particular, if we have some estimates of this, we may as well impose that this is equal to j. I mean, this is not a proof. This is just a formal discussion, but I think that is, it has the right intuition. So yeah, exactly. This is what we want. This doesn't depend on you. We can write it like this. And this is just the ith element of the matrix multiplication KV. So matrix vector multiplication KV. So this is UIKV. So that means that if we have some estimate of P, then we can get an estimate of U by setting UI to mu I over this thing here. And then if we do this for all I, we get a new coupling of this form from UKV that has the correct first marginal, but that may not have the correct second marginal. So we run it again, but with the reversed roles, and we get something that has the correct second marginal, but that doesn't have the correct first marginal. And keeping iterating this is the synchron algorithm that is used to solve this entropic OT problem. So yeah, exactly. You update your first scaling factor by doing element-wise division by this matrix vector multiplication, and the same on the other side, and then you converge to the optimal scalings that you saw here. This is the basis of all the implementations of solving this entropic, regularized, optimal transport. And actually, it works fairly well. You need many iterations, maybe 100,000 iterations. But again, this is just matrix vector multiplication, so it runs kind of fast. And yeah, exactly. So it's basically what everyone or most of the people are using to solve entropic OT. But there are a couple of problems. The first problem is that keeping this matrix sparse is very non-trivial because you don't know where the mass will be. So in this picture here, you need to keep this mass, this with enough mass, but you don't know in principle where that is. And the second part is that parallelization is in practice restricted to a single machine because if you parallelize a matrix vector multiplication over several workers, then you may end up using more time in communicating the result back for the next iteration than actually doing the computation. So this means that in practice, you only parallelize it locally, maybe with a GPU, but only locally. And then it's only suitable for middle-sized problems that fits on your RAM or a bit more maybe, but not incredibly big. So that's where our domain decomposition comes into play. And this, I don't know how am I with time.
I think you still have some time. No?
Okay. So this domain decomposition idea is, okay, if we cannot solve the big OT problem, we may as well divide it into small chunks, then solve them in parallel using even several workers, and then combining the chunks together with their respective optimal solution. And by doing this in a clever way, we may be able to allow information to travel between the different chunks when we do the next iteration, so that we after iterating this a lot of times, we end up with the optimal global solution. So this is just the idea, not why it works. But if this works, at least it is simple, because on each subproblem, we just use some OT solver that we know as some black box for solving the OT problem. And it's also parallelizable because of what I said before. You just send a subproblem to a worker, leave it to work, and only transfer back the solution when it's done with that problem. So the ratio of communication time over computational time is very low. So we just have to show that it works in practice. So let's show what I meant by this dividing the problem into small chunks so that you get some intuition. The idea is the following. We start with some initial coupling that may not be optimal. For example, here, the optimal coupling would be to send the first mass to the first mass, the second mass to the second mass, and so on. But we start with something that is completely wrong, that is sending the first chunk of mass to the last chunk of mass, and so on. So what do? We restrict ourselves to just a part of the domain X. We look at the part of the coupling that is mapped by this, that are these 3 points. And then we look at the part in Y that also talks to these points. And then we have a smaller problem because we would like to solve how to send these 3 points to these 3 points here. And then when we solve it, we have gotten something that is a bit better. And how do we proceed now? We choose another different partition. In this case, we are choosing this. And then it shows that these three guys talk to these three guys here. So we solve this subproblem again. And so by keeping doing this, iterating this, we can finally slowly keep improving our map and converge maybe to the optimal solution. And if you had more points here, so for example, instead of three or maybe with three, you could do, instead of sending those 3 points, you could send this small problem to one worker and this smaller problem to another worker, leave it to work in parallel, and then get it back. In principle, if you have a much larger problem, you can decompose it into a lot more chunks. So here comes the parallelization. So now that we saw that in this simple example, it seems to work, I have to say that it doesn't work in general in the discrete setting for unregularized OT. So if you just have the general OT problem, it turns out that for absolutely continuous mu, for example, when mu is a density with respect to the homogeneous density, then it works. But if you discretize it, it doesn't need to work for the unregularized OT problem. So for the original OT problem. But then last year, my supervisor and Mauro Bonafini proved that if you have the entropic OT problem, so if you have regularization, it does actually converge, and it doesn't need to be just the squared cause as it was in the original paper that outlined this domain decomposition. But for any bounded cause, if you have a partition that is connected in the sense that it allows information to travel, then the iterates will converge to the optimal solution of the entropic OT problem. That's a nice first point. A small caveat is that the theoretical convergence rate can be very bad. But actually, when they run when we run this algorithm, we don't observe that in geometric problems, so to say. So when we have some density and we discretize it and some other density, it doesn't need to be smooth. It can have jumps, and then we discretize. So our subdomains are nice partitions. So just, some partitions that are composed by blocks next to each other and so on. So we don't do stupid stuff with which partitions do we use. Then we converge very, very quickly to the optimal solution. So they show this heuristically in their paper. And then when I started working with them, we started trying to understand this fast convergence better in this paper that I think I won't have a lot of time to talk about, but that you can take a look. We do this by taking these subdomains where we are solving the OT problem and making them smaller and smaller and smaller, and seeing that this process of the domain decomposition algorithm actually converges to a continuity equation, so to an evolution PDE, and we can study that PDE to obtain information about this domain decomposition algorithm. Just the last thing that I want to say is that there's a jury implementation of this domain decomposition algorithm. You have the link there. And do you see now a new window? So with another picture?
Yes, you can see.
Okay. So there are some notebooks that show how to use it and where you can play with it, and actually by doing some multi-scale resolutions, so first solving coarse problems and then giving the information down to finer and finer problems, you get some very good quality optimal transport plans. Yeah, exactly. So this, just to summarize, we have seen a bit about what the optimal transport problem is about, what the Bassel's time distance is about, that it can be applied to problems in computer science and in the natural science, in particular in microscopy. It also can be used in astronomy data, for example. And if your problem is medium-sized, there are some libraries, for example, this Python optimal transport library, or optimal transport if you use Julia, as I do, optimal transport, that have nice implementations of the synchron algorithm for medium-sized problems, even with GPU acceleration and so on. And if you really want to go big and do distributed computing, you should go for something along, like, for example, the domain decomposition, and there's some implementation to take a look here.
Okay, thank you very much, Ismael.